He was lifting me up. He was transforming me. But it did not happen without the struggle. That's why Jesus said, if you wish to be my disciple, you must deny yourself. Who wants to do that? Pick up your cross and follow me. My brothers, my sisters, that's real. The devil wants you to have an aversion of that. Jesus said, no. Pick up your cross and follow me. So I remember driving to this retreat, and I thought, okay, I'm going to give this my best shot. But I almost had a doubt in my mind, that the spirit of doubt was trying to tell me that nothing was going to change. But during the retreat, very early on, I had this dream, and I wrote it down, and this is the dream. I was walking, and it was so clear in my head, I was there. I was walking along this grassy knoll, right at the base of the knoll, and the knoll went up. And then I started to go up. The sky was as crystal blue as you can imagine. I walked to the top of the knoll, and I stand there, and to my happy, happy surprise, there's the sea. Beautiful. Beautiful. And right down on the shore, there's a huge sailboat. Big. Jesus uses images you can understand. I had my sailing license. I'm a sailor. There's Jesus. And Jesus is right next to that boat, and he's saying, Dan, come here. I run down from the knoll, down to the boat. And in the dream, I was so happy I could hardly stand it. And then Jesus said to me, Dan, you want to go out for a sail? And I said, yes. And as I was saying yes, the boat shrank. Just shrank. It shrank into like this small, almost a toy boat. And I looked at the boat and I said, Lord, what? And as I looked at the boat, I looked at Jesus, and from the grown man, he became the little boy. Because I said, how are we going to get in the boat? And I looked down at Jesus, and he looked right in my eyes. He said, if you become little too, we can both get in the boat, and I'll take you out. Mm. And that was the end of the dream. Don't forget that dream. Remember it, because I'm going to refer back to it in a little bit. So I wrote this down, and then I would go to my spiritual director in the afternoon, every day, and speak with them about what Jesus said to me, and my recorded dreams. So I recorded the dream, and my director said to me, Father, what's Jesus saying to you in that dream? Well, it must be he wants me to become little. And then the scripture comes to mind, unless you become like a little child, you cannot enter the kingdom of God. Remember what John the Baptist said? He must increase, I must decrease. So here's Jesus preparing me in my heart. This was on the first day. I mean, the first day of the retreat, this is what happened. So I start going through the retreat, and now I have a sense I need to become little. And then Jesus speaks again. But he speaks to me in a voice that I can hear. I'm right before the Blessed Sacrament. I'm right there praising thee. I'm just there quietly, right before Jesus in the Blessed Sacrament. And I hear these words. And he said my full name. He said, Daniel. He didn't say Dan. He said, Daniel, remember, this is my work, and I will do it. Daniel, this is my work, and I will do it. Everybody, do you see what Jesus is saying? Do I need to get out of the way?
Yes. You and I are not God. We're instruments of God. And so Jesus was lovingly reminding me that everything is his work. Everything. So I'm writing all this stuff down. Then Jesus speaks to me in a dream, and I want to read it to you. This was on July 25th, 2001, Feast of St. James the Apostle. Last night I dreamt that I was climbing a mountain in Montana with my family. My father was on the trail, my sister Michelle, and my mom was there, but could not see her in my immediate surroundings. There was snow on the ground, and the sun trickled in around us. To my left, I saw a ram that was bucking heads with several rams. This ram seemed to be the dominant ram, and as each ram bucked his head, they fell down into submission to him. The other rams were big, small, young, and old. Now there's more to that dream, but I want to just section this part off first. You ever seen the ram commercial, the big rams with curly horns and they buck heads? My director told me every time I had a dream that Jesus would interpret it for me, just to go back before the Eucharist and listen, and Jesus will interpret it. So I went back in front of the Eucharist, and this is what Jesus showed me. The Lord showed me that the ram in my dream, bucking heads with the other rams, was the Word of God living in me. As the Word was being spoken, it touched the heart of each person. Blindness was healed. Deafness was healed, and the Word reigned over them, and all gave their hearts to doing the will of our Father. Is the Lord trying to kick me in the behind? Watch this, everybody. I drive all the way back to Illinois from Nebraska. After this 9-day retreat, there's a box waiting for me from the Franklin Mint. And my father sent me a birthday gift, my dad. After having this retreat, he sent me a gift from the Franklin Mint. I opened that box, and this is what was in that box. You cannot strip this stuff. But remember what Jesus said to me in my dream. That ram represents the Word of God in you. And when you speak the Word of God, remember the other rams came in contact with the horns of the other ram? As you speak the Word of God, those who are listening, blindness will be healed. Deafness will be healed. And those who listen will surrender themselves to the will of our Father. Now, picture me on the retreat, not having received this. I had no idea this was coming. Is this a confirmation of God's word and what he said to me? Can you strip this stuff? No. But one thing I did not have at that time, I did not have a real love of the Word of God. Of course, I preach the Word of God. I mean, is that, how can that be, Father? How can you say you're a priest and you don't have a love? In all humility, my love for Scripture came with my love for Jesus. Not just knowing about Jesus, but knowing Jesus. Do you see the difference? knowing about Jesus and knowing him. As I go through my very personal and private diary of what Jesus said to me, God's love for me, his love for you, is eternal. Everybody knows favorite scripture, Jeremiah 1, verse 5. Before you were in the womb, I knew you. What does that mean to you? We got to wake up. Wake up, too. And we just ate. What does it mean? Do you know what it means, everybody? Before you were in the womb, I knew you. Is there anybody here who feels like they're a mistake? It's part of the healing ministry. I've prayed over many who were told they were a mistake. Or your mother and I did not plan on having you. Or we wanted a girl instead of a boy. All of these false judgment statements. I formed you in your mother's womb. Is there a detail about your life that God doesn't know about? No. It was not you who chose me. It was I who chose you. Jesus said, if you live in my word, you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free. I will send you the Holy Spirit who will remind you of everything that I told you. So on this retreat, Jesus was melding me, or welding me, however you want to call it, my heart to be united with Jesus intimately. I didn't have priests growing up teaching about an intimate relationship with God. They never even mentioned a word. I hardly even remember a relationship being mentioned. But when you hear Jesus answer the question of the scribe, Rabbi, which is the greatest of all the commandments? And God said, this is the greatest. Love me with all your heart, with all your mind, all your body, and with all your strength. And so, you have to see yourself, and at this time in my priesthood, over this silent retreat, God is bringing me deeper into this word, understanding, looking at a much bigger picture. My goodness, many times we just look at the little crumb when we need to look at the big picture. Do I think for a second that God is not going to see me through? What does Jesus say? You can do nothing without me. You can do nothing. How humbling is that for all of us to really embrace it and get it? At the end of this retreat, there was a team of about 20 sisters and priests that prayed over me. And my goodness, everybody, to receive prayer. How many of you have received what we call soaking prayer? You're like soaked in it. You're through the laying on of hands. Have you received the laying on of hands just being prayed over? You have? Okay. How many have not? I mean, you haven't had the experience. Okay? Up to that point, I hadn't had the experience. It wasn't, not like this. But I was in this room, this chapel. They surrounded me, and I was sitting in a chair. And I'm telling you, it was almost as if a tsunami came through that room. It was so powerful and so incredibly beautiful that I didn't want it to end. That's my real big deal, encounter with the Holy Spirit. Through the laying on of hands. And everybody was there just loving me, praying in the name of Jesus, the Spirit of God, into my heart, into my mind, into my body. Now, it gets better.